Greetings, my name is Jerry Mihay, and I welcome you to American Pie 2021. I would like to begin by thanking you for taking some of your time to spend with us. Our commitment to you is the enjoyment of every minute of our show. This year, we are commemorating our 37th consecutive event, and would like to thank our long-standing patrons for their unwavering dedication and support. We are so looking forward to resuming live performance next year, but for now, we will provide a sample of 50s, 60s, and 70s music that will mark a return to the roots of our very first show. That said, what you are about to see is a live performance video of our current cast of performers. For the uninitiated, American Pie came to be as a project in the history classes of Columbus North teacher Ed Nesbajani. When his class lesson drew too many students from elsewhere, disrupting attendance in the process, he was kindly asked to present the lesson in the evening. Ed's creative history lesson was further augmented soon after when Columbus North English teacher Dennis Lindsay came on board as a collaborator, working with Ed for better than two decades. Thank you both for your vision. Sit back with friends or loved ones and enjoy our show.
The decade of the 1950s was shaped by an array of forces that would include the availability of modern consumer products, the Cold War, and the ever-growing and restless younger generation. This generation would begin rejecting the trappings of their parents as they searched for their own identity. No longer constrained by the economics of the Great Depression and World War II, or the oppression of anti-communist McCarthyism, fast cars and rock and roll music were two sure tickets to escape the boredom and repression. These youthful feelings saw their best expression through James Dean in his blockbuster Hollywood debut, Rebel Without a Cause. Glenn Ford starring in Blackboard Jungle, writer Jack Kerouac's groundbreaking literary piece On the Road, and the ethnic mix of rock and roll. Young listeners would begin to enjoy the variety of artists such as Bill Haley, Little Richard Pennyman, Chuck Berry, and the king himself, Elvis Presley. Performing for you the Elvis Presley hit, Heartbreak Hotel, will be Columbus East student Ira Montgomery.
Well, since my baby left me, well, I found a new place to dwell. Well, it's not the end of lonely street at Heartbreak Hotel. Tears keep flowing, the desolate stress and black. Well, it's been so long on lonely street, they'll never, never look back.
Thank you.
suit rather in a blue.
During the Dust Bowl days of the Great Depression, scores of families packed up their belongings and migrated to the temperate environs of California. The defense industry of World War II enjoyed the abundance of physical space and an ever-growing workforce, and would provide an environment of sustained prosperity. The early years of the 1960s in California would become a hotbed for the ever-increasing popularity and national exposure of surfing. At the same time, sounds blasting from the newly introduced electric guitars and amplifiers produced by a man named Leo Fender would provide an exciting soundtrack. Mix the two and surf music was born. Artists like Dick Dale would use their electric instruments to emulate the dynamics of the waves and water, the beauty and the danger. The American Pie Band will now perform for you a popular example of this music, Walk, Don't Run by The Ventures. Popular music was enjoying a tremendous period of growth and an expansive range of songs. The art of writing hits soon became an integral part of the musical for recording. Girl groups, as they were often referred to, would experience a surge in popularity in the early to mid 1960s. As recording production techniques improved, the sweet harmonies of young ladies provided the basis for many hit records. Groups such as the Dixie Cups, the Crystals, the Ronettes, Martha and the Vandellas, the Chiffons, and the Shangri-Las enjoyed much success and great notoriety during this time. The Chiffons sang about the ideal guy in a song, He's So Fine, which will be performed for you by Olivia Pittman and Naomi Gambrell, Ella Fisher, and Jenna Gaffron. He's So Fine will be followed by Remember, Walking in the Sand. The Shangri-Las tended toward the melodramatic with their hit Remember Walkin' in the Sand. This reading will be performed by Molly Hotek with Austin Weber, Sophia Martinez, Vanessa Holloway, and Alana Thomas, based on a remake of the song by some famous fans of the Shangri-Las, Hall of Fame rock band Aerosmith. By late 1963, the music business in the United States was abuzz with the anticipated arrival of a group of four young men who were taking their native Great Britain by storm. Finally, in early February of 1964, the Beatles made their American debut on the Ed Sullivan Show, and the course of rock music was forever changed. From that moment until their demise in 1970, they unquestionably set the new standard for everyone else to follow. Legions of young females would be spellbound, and countless young males, as if struck by lightning, would pick up guitars and drums, all caught in a dream. By the time their eager fans heard their latest recordings, the Beatles were already speeding ahead with their newest musical journey. Although their contemporaries worked tirelessly to catch up, the Beatles remained in a league of their own, something others could only envy or aspire to. We have selected for you the song Yellow Submarine from their 1966 album Revolver. This musical gem would serve as the theme for a full feature animated film of the same name, created and released 2 years later. Singing Yellow Submarine for you will be Fisher Mantooth with Jaime Garcia and Kevin Graham, plus Ben Richards, Sidney Guthrie, Zoe Doherty, Trinity Wright, Lulu Young, Austin Clark, Ira Montgomery, Evie Polyak, Hannah Franklin, Sarah Adams, and Amelia Maddox, featuring the American Pie Horns led by North Assistant Band Director, Mr. Keith Burton.
In the town where I was born, lived a man who sailed the sea, and he told us of his life in the land of submarines. So we sailed into the sun till we found the sea of greens, and we lived beneath the waves in our yellow submarine.
As the decade changed, it was apparent that the youthful innocence of an earlier time would vanish forever. The summative optimism of the legendary Woodstock Festival would be eclipsed by the tragedy and chaos of a free concert at Altamont Speedway in Northern California in December 1969, headlined by the Rolling Stones. By 1969 and 1970, rock music was reaching a new level of sophistication. In addition to recording production taking another leap forward in quality, music composition became more complex, and lyrics became more critical of society and less friendly, exhibiting a harder edge. The youthful attitude was becoming serious and cynical, and the Beatles were in their final days together. With their debut album, Chicago would be a musical tour de force, combining jazz-influenced horns with an absolute rocking band and three singers, solid in their own styles and formidable as a combination. Singing the Chicago song Beginnings will be Richards Elementary teacher Jeff Bray, backed by Columbus North Choir director Jenny Gaffron. Keeping things real will be the American Pie Horns.
Thank you.
it to you. Oh, 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 oh. Mostly I'm silent, silent, yeah. I'm silent. Silent when I kiss you, I feel a thousand different feelings, the color of chills all over my body. And when I feel them, just to start. I've got to get you into my life, baby. I've got to get you next to me. Only the beginning. Ooh. Only just to start. Only just to start.
As time progressed in the 60s, performance venues became larger, requiring more production. This in turn would increase the expectations of a performance. Audiences were only satisfied if the performance would actually become an event of large proportion, the bigger the better, and we've been there ever since. By 1970, Led Zeppelin would emerge as one of the heaviest of the heavies. Their simple format of guitar, bass, drums, and lead singer would be characterized by the virtuosity of its individual members. In spite of their heavy reputation, they also proved to be anyone's equal in the realm of folk music, a rare combination indeed. We have chosen to show the heavy side of Led Zeppelin with Immigrant Song from Led Zeppelin III, performed for you by Columbus North Choir Director Jennifer Gaffron with Columbus North student Colby Lovins on guitar.
They say that timing is everything, and no one knows that better than Neil Young. As a member of Buffalo Springfield, a talented band struggling to break big, Neil Young had advanced his songwriting skills and song catalog enough to begin recording as a solo act. The magnitude of his ability as a songwriter and performer would result in his being asked to join the new popular supergroup, Crosby, Stills, and Nash, and eventually Young. Their collective talent as songwriters was landmark, but their legend as live performers brought them critical acclaim as well. After penning and recording the song Ohio literally within a few days of the Kent State shootings in May of 1970, Young was acclaimed for his willingness to criticize contemporary events. However, Neil Young would soon depart once again, opting to resume a successful solo career that continues to this day. Columbus North graduate and American Pie veteran Tony London will perform Southern Man, a song in which Mr. Young addresses the immorality of slavery in the American South. Providing backing vocals will be Columbus North students Alex Holloway, Anna Jackson, and Zoe Dougherty.
Southern man,
The one-hit wonder continued to be a staple element of popular songs heard on commercial radio. Everything from novelty songs to displays of social consciousness were possibilities. Most artists would fade into obscurity, while some might be lucky enough to find fortune in other musical ventures or projects. One band that could claim that dubious distinction would be the five-man electrical band and their 1971 hit single, Signs, a song decrying bias and prejudice in American society. This song will be performed by Columbus North social studies teacher Jerry Mihay with Columbus North students Alex Holloway, Brianna Guthrie, Emma Krim, Evie Polyak, and McCartney Elliott contributing backing vocals.
Need not apply. So I tucked my hair up under my hat and I went in to ask him why. He said, "You look like a fine, upstanding young man. I think you do." So I took off my hat and said, "Imagine that, put me working for you." Shot on sight. So I jumped on a fence and I yelled to the house, "Hey, what gives you the right to put up a fence to keep me out or to keep Mother Nature in? If God was here, he'd tell it to your face, man, you're some kind of sinner." Sign, sign, everywhere I sign, blocking up the scenery, breaking my membership card to get inside. And the sign said, "Everybody welcome, come in, kneel down and pray." When they pass around a plate at the end of it all, I didn't have a penny to pay. So I got me a pen and a paper, and I made up my own little sign. I said, "Thank you, Lord, for thinking about me. I'm alive and doing fine." Whoa, sign, sign, everywhere I sign, locking up the scenery, breaking my mind. Do this, don't do that, can't you read the sign? Sign, sign, everywhere.
By the late 1960s, Miles Davis, one of the biggest names in jazz, began applying rock music sounds to his compositions, proving that both sounds could complement one another. Rock musician, composer Frank Zappa, hitmaker Chicago, and a host of other rock performers were also sharing a path similar to Davis. As the 60s became the 70s, elements from rhythm and blues would add yet another dimension to this evolving sound that would be referred to as fusion. By 1974, Richard Nixon was gone, and Gerald Ford became the first appointed president in American history. The Average White Band would hit the charts with the right combination of ingredients in a song titled Pick Up the Pieces, served up by the American Pie Horns, featuring Keith Burton on trumpet and Columbus North band director Brian Munoz on trombone, with Columbus North alum Clayton Stein on saxophone.
Thank you.
The excessive and non-traditional values of the 1960s counterculture had become mainstream by the 1970s. People were not shocked by much anymore, not even nude people streaking in public settings. Despite the distractions of society, the creation of what is now referred to as classic rock would continue unabated. 1976 would witness the release of one of the year's best albums and the debut by newcomers Heart, a hard-rocking band featuring sisters Ann and Nancy Wilson. Having previously performed as a duo, their paths would diverge, with Ann becoming the lead singer for a powerful new rock band, while sister Nancy, an accomplished guitarist and singer, pursued a college education. Ann was finally able to convince her sister to visit and sit in with the new band, resulting in Nancy becoming the final piece to the puzzle. After their successful first album, a quick follow-up would be assembled to satisfy a previous legal claim, but Heart were hardly standing still. From the album magazine, the song Heartless will be performed by Columbus North Spanish teacher Rebecca Burbrink with Columbus North student Hannah Franklin.
Thank you.
each and every individual involved in the production of American Pie would wish to take a moment to thank those who have dedicated themselves to the well-being of others and to recognize the loss of loved ones from our global community to COVID-19. We all feel truly blessed to have the opportunity and ability to share a few moments of our joy and happiness with you. Now we bid you goodbye with that classic piece by Cool and the Gang that summarizes all of our good fortune, Celebration, performed for you by the American Pie Band and the Columbus North Choir.